So thanks everyone for sticking around today. As Josh said, I took on the idea of investigating poaching by fishers when I was kind of looking around for what I was going to do during a PhD. And I came to JCU in 2011 to do a master's degree, and when I was there, I was trying to think of what a good research project would be. And rather than looking at what everyone else was doing and what was kind of on the frontier, I was sitting in Gary Russ's class one day, and he was talking about compliance and how it's a primary expectation when we make these no-take marine reserves. But then the striking thing was that nobody was really studying it. And so at first it was like, well, this is a little bit counterintuitive. Why doesn't anybody look at it? And then I thought a little bit deeper, and it was, you know, blatantly obvious. If you have the idea or the choice of going and chasing fish on a coral reef or going and chasing salty fishermen and asking them about illegal behavior, you know, what's the average person gonna do? So in that way, I decided to be a bit of a glutton for punishment and chase the fishermen rather than the fish. So when I started my PhD, this was the headline that came out. And for a few years before that, word on the street was that illegal offenses by recreational fishers were on the rise. And this quote came out from the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park in 2015, I believe. And it was also due to the fact that they realized this was an ongoing issue and they started targeting it more. So what do I mean by poaching? For the purpose of this talk, I'm referring to poaching as fishing inside a no-take marine reserve. And I may be lecturing to the choir here, but poaching can have some serious consequences. The first of ecological consequences, right? So the most obvious one is the fact that poaching, even short bursts of poaching, can drastically reduce or negate your no-take marine reserve outcomes. And Russ and Alcala documented a 67% reduction in predatory fish biomass in 2 to 3 months when protection broke down. And socially, you have numerous consequences as well. So if a compliant fisherman sees poachers that are effectively free riding or breaking the rules and getting away from it, this can lead to situations that reduce your support for no-take marine reserves and ultimately potentially end up at a situation where poaching is a socially acceptable behavior. And that ends in this common tragedy of the paper park that you may or may not have heard before. So with that, I want to move to what our approach was that led to being honored with this award. And since it's Friday afternoon and we've all sat through 2 days of talks, I'm assuming that everybody's brain probably looks like that walnut shell up there, right? And cognitive research tells us that the average human being can hold on to 3 to 7 new facts. So I'm gonna try to err on the bottom side rather than the top side. So my talk's based around 4 key findings that we produced during our research. The first is that of poaching hotspots. The second is the prevalence of poaching in the recreational fisher community. The third is motivations to poach, or why are these people doing it? And then the fourth is voluntary reporting of poaching by fishermen. And the reason we used all these different approaches was, again, because poaching is an inherently difficult thing to ask and get information on. So it's really valuable to try to approach it from as many different directions or lenses as you can. And in the end, this helps optimize enforcement and communication strategies when you're actually in the day-to-day grind of compliance management. So in 2012, we wanted to know what this looked like on the water. Could we detect it? So we went out to 2 inshore island groups that received considerable fishing pressure by recreational fishers. And we went to 30 different sites, 15 of which were in no-take reserves, and 15 of which were paired with fish sites. So we went and we counted, and then we cleaned lines on all these sites. And then in 2014, we came back to all these sites again, and we counted all the line that accumulated since then. And the first thing I want to draw your attention to is the dotted lines here. So the dotted lines represent your mean accumulation density of lines per site at either no fishing sites or fish sites, excuse me. And what you notice here is the dotted lines are pretty much the exact similar level. So we found no difference in accumulation rates of line between no-take zones and fish zones. And the second thing I want to focus your attention on is these bars that are in red. So these are our poaching hotspots, which we characterized at any site that had a higher degree of line accumulation than the mean for no fishing sites. And when you look at what that translates to on the map and where they are, you see that they're often located right near the edge of no-take marine reserves. Whereas in the Palm Islands, these were often areas that were pretty much out of sight, out of mind. They allowed people to get in and get out without being observed. In the Whitsundays, it was the opposite, right? So the two sites here, Blue Pearl Bay and Langford Island, and these are right next to a large tourist resort, and they both of these areas receive heaps of tourism pressure and use every day. So to us, this suggested that there is a proportion of poaching activities that were happening at night, which has since been confirmed by the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park Authority's Field Compliance Unit. So the one distinction I want to make here is about sites 12 and 13. These are both located in Curaçao Island, and traditional owners are legally able to fish in these sites. So there is definitely the potential for an accumulation or inflation of the accumulation rates. But the point that I want to make here is that if we expect these sites to be functioning as no-take marine reserves, you see that they're receiving just as much, if not more, fishing pressure than the rest of the no-take marine reserves around the area. So it kind of makes us reconsider what we expect from some of these areas, right? Now, the second thing we wanted to know was what the actual prevalence of poaching was in the recreational fisher community. So to do this, we went out to Townsville boat ramps over 16 months. We surveyed roughly 700 fishers. And we used five different methods that were very good and designed to reduce social desirability bias. Because, of course, asking somebody if they poach, you're never going to get a positive answer, right? So this is a fairly good result if you consider the fact that most of the MPAs throughout the world have much higher levels of noncompliance than what we found on the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park. But then if you think about the fact that roughly 170,000 recreational fishers live adjacent to the marine park, this translates into some big numbers. So if these results are representative of the entire rec fishing population, this could suggest that anywhere between 5,000 and 22,000 recreational fishers poached in the last year on the Great Barrier Reef. And a second thing that we found that we weren't expecting was a significant pulse in poaching activity over a holiday weekend with good weather. And in this case, 47% of respondents admitted with our best developed sensitive questioning technique to fishing over that three-day weekend, right? So the third thing we wanted to know about was, why are people poaching? And of course, again, you can't ask somebody why they poach because they're going to tell you they don't poach. So a way to get around this is to ask people, why do you think others are poaching? Right? And so this basically like puts a little bit of distance between a person and somebody else, and it allows them to project their beliefs onto other people's behavior. And what we found was that there's two main perceived motivations to poach, and that was the idea that there's better fishing in reserves and a low risk of detection, rather than poaching that would potentially occur as an act of defiance, protest, or rebellion. And so if you're a poacher, this may well be what a no-take marine reserve looked like to you on a map. You know that there's better fishing and there's a low risk of detection. And this is an outcome that we need to think about a little bit more, because when they rezoned the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park, there was a lot of emphasis on telling people that these reserves are working and we need to protect them. And they're giving us better fish, right? But in the end, when that's paired with a low risk of detection, that could potentially be encouraging situations in which people are actually going out to poach because they know that there's better fish there and they're probably not going to get caught, right? So the next point I want to make is that enforcement patrols are incredibly expensive, both in time and in money. So you need to optimize your enforcement as much as possible. And I just told you earlier that we were able to find specific times and specific places that poaching was occurring. And on the Great Barrier Reef, they use a risk-based management system that allows them to send their patrols to times and places when they think there's going to be a risk of poaching. And again, we found that people are potentially poaching because it's opportunistic. So if we're communicating to them, well, these reserves are working, all we're doing is encouraging them to go back into them anyways. So we need to increase the risk of detection. One way of doing this is to engage fishers in reporting observed poaching when they're out on the water. So we asked fishers, have you seen poaching? And if you've seen it, what have you done? And unfortunately, 75% of people told us they kicked their feet back and did nothing about it. So these guys represent a substantial amount of human capital that could be activated to act as eyes and ears on the water. But they gave us three common reasons for not doing anything. The first was the idea that, well, we were uncertain, we decided we'd give them the benefit of the doubt. The second was, you know what, it's not my concern, that's the Marine Park's job, not mine. And the third were these obstacles to reporting, such as not knowing how to report or not having cell reception. And so the Great Barrier Reef does use a reporting hotline, but in this context, they're gonna need to get past some, you know, potential barriers here to try to encourage fishers that it is their concern and that, you know, reporting poachers is something that everyone should do. So in different situations in the United States, there's anti-poaching hotlines that are active in all 50 states. And there's also a Crime Stoppers program that functions here in Australia and elsewhere. And these programs have been very effective because not only do they increase your group cohesion, they increase the relations between the resource users and the management or the enforcement personnel. And finally, they act as future deterrents or deterrents against future crimes, right? So I'll leave you with a few take-home messages. The first is that the admitted poaching rate was somewhere between 3 and 13%. I want to emphasize the fact that this is admitted. So you're asking about illegal behavior, you're probably going to get a lower level of poaching that's reported rather than a higher, right? The second is that poaching hotspots do exist, and they're typically near the edges of no-take zones. And the third is that fishers in the Great Barrier Reef could be further engaged to report and therefore reduce ongoing poaching activities. And as Josh was saying, the award that I won was because apparently my research had a little bit of an impact on the way things were happening with management. And I was lucky enough to, throughout my PhD, have a very close collaboration with the Great Barrier Reef Marine Parks Field Compliance Unit, which is a mouthful. But over that time, they were able to take some of the results that we were getting, and they were able to use it to change the way that they communicate about compliance. And so in the last few years, you may or may not have seen more and more press releases that are highlighting the fact that there are patrols out there. These patrols are happening all the time. They're also trying to emphasize the fact that it's everyone's responsibility or concern to report poachers, and in that way, trying to increase the perceived threat of detection, right? And so with that, I'd like to thank you all for listening to me talk, and I'd also like to thank the ARC Center of Excellence for Coral Reef Studies, the Great Barrier Reef Marine Park Authority, and finally, the three advisors who are hopefully still sitting here in the audience today that without my research would have never gone through. So Josh, Gary, Dave, thanks very much.